Welcome to another edition of Afikra's Book Club. Our special guest today is Joumana Haddad, who is an award-winning Lebanese author, journalist, and human rights activist. She was the culture editor at Ennahda newspaper for many years and now hosts a TV show focusing on human rights issues in the Arab world. She's received the Blue Metropolis Arab Literary Prize and the Arab Press Prize, among many other honors, and was named one of the world's 100 most powerful Arab women for 4 years in a row by Arabian Business. You might know her work from Superman is an Arab or I Kill Shahrazad, The Third Sex, and many of her other books. But today we're going to be talking about the Book of Queens. Joumana, welcome to Afikra Book Club.
Thank you so much. I'm honored and so happy to participate. And I can't wait for your questions.
Yeah, I'm excited as well. You know, I want to start talking just briefly about the first couple of words I read in your bio, which is you are an author and a journalist. And some people only know you, at least in Lebanon, they only know you as a journalist. Very prominently, you know, Ennahda is one of the leading newspapers in the country, and they know you very prominently as that. When you think about yourself, do you think about yourself in that order, author, journalist, activist, or is there a different hierarchy?
That's quite an interesting question. I would say, yeah, but even before author, poet, and then author, and then activist, I guess, and then journalist. Not because not because journalism is, the least in my list of interests, but because I started it not out of passion necessarily, but out of having to do some kind of work in order to survive. Because as an author, as a poet, I could not, especially in the Arab world, I could not conceive being able to become self-sufficient financially, just relying on my books and my poetry. So I came to it just in order to be doing something that involves words, because this is my main, weapon in life. But that would allow me a certain financial stability. But once I started doing it, and I was lucky enough to be working in a field that was also in a field of journalism that is also very close to my own interests. At Ennahda for 20 years, it was the cultural page. And now as a TV host, it's a show about human rights. When I started, I became quite passionate about it and excited about it. But it wasn't like that in the beginning. Ever since I was a little girl, I always thought of myself as a writer and as an astronaut for a brief period of time. Then I realized how much I sucked at math and physics, so I had to let go of that dream.
Yeah, my mom broke the news to me when I was 10 years old that I wasn't going to be 6'10" and I wasn't going to become a professional basketball player. It was a heartbreaking
yeah. moment for me. We all go through that some way or another.
So I want to jump right into the book because I have so many questions about this. The Book of Queens. And the first question I have is, you know, most people ask this question to authors, who is this book for? But this is, it's historical fiction, but it is clearly part memoir. And it's very much you sort of thinking through the story of your family and sort of the tragic elements and the resilient elements of your family. But would you, if you were not a published author, if Simon & Schuster and Interlink wouldn't have come to you and said, we're going to publish this, did you have to write this book just for yourself, essentially?
I did. I actually did need to write that book eventually. And I believe that I would go even further. I've started writing I felt the need to write in order to be able to write this book in particular one day, once I was ready to do that, because it wasn't an easy confrontation. It wasn't an easy book to write. So, I mean, the first part of your question, the one you didn't ask me, who is this book for? I was about to say, had you asked me the question, this book is for me, first and foremost. I needed to write it. I needed to, not in order to liberate myself from the story or the stories in plural that I had inside and that were and still are weighing on my identity and my vision of life and the way I express myself and the way I do things, but also and mainly because I didn't actually liberate myself of those, because I needed to put it down on paper in order for it to not be just part of my own imagination and memory. I needed to share it with others. So in order to explain myself better and in order to explain why it was so hard to write this book, but also so vital and necessary for me. I mean, you said historical fiction, but it is biographical as well, because it was about the story of my grandmother, my Armenian grandmother, who had survived the genocide in 1915. She was just 3 years old at the time. And then many, many years later, many hardships later, and a life full of challenges, and also, I guess, beautiful experiences later. When I was 7 years old, she committed suicide. And I was, that was my introduction to both death and suicide, which are two thorny things to think about for a seven-year-old. I mean, even if I was living the war in Beirut at the time, it started when I was 5 years old, I hadn't seen death in the face. And here I was having to face what death meant, but also what self-administered death meant. And I had obsessed about her and about that decision that she took all of my life. And I had dealt with suicide also before this book, but in a form of an anthology that I did, a huge anthology of 700 pages about poets who committed suicide. But I always knew I had to tell her story. And it wasn't easy because suicide is a taboo still, unfortunately, I guess not only in Lebanon and in the Arab world, but in many other parts of the world. And my mom and my uncles and aunts didn't want to talk about it. So I had to do my own homework, and I also had to put my imagination at test in order to complete the pieces of the puzzle, because I didn't just want to tell her story. Her story was just a prototype of many stories of suffering and loss.
It's almost like it's like an untellable story internally. And so in some ways you sort of fictionalize, you have to fictionalize in order to fill in those gaps that are unknowable and untellable. One of my favorite comedians wrote a book, and it's fiction, but he says it's fiction, but it's true. That's how I felt about this book. I want to read just the little paragraph about the book for those people who are unfamiliar. It says the Book of Queens is a family saga that spans four generations of women caught up in the tragic whirlwind of turf wars and suffering in the Middle East, from the Armenian genocide and the Israeli occupation of Palestine to modern day civil wars and the struggles between Christians and Muslims in Lebanon and Syria. Four queens of a deck of cards dealt a bad hand by fate. And I want to actually have you read these four women's names, because they're names that, except the last one, are I'm unfamiliar with. So tell me who these women are and how you arrived upon these names.
Okay, so the first woman, the great grandmother, is Kaya. Then I skip a generation, and the next chapter is about Kana, the mother. Qatar is the Kana is the the granddaughter. Qatar is the mother, and Kamar is the great granddaughter. And I'm gonna tell you, these weren't the names at the start of the writing process. You know, it's so interesting. The other day I was just looking into my archive and I saw a very early draft of the book. First of all, it was just about my grandmother. It was just about the Armenian genocide. That's how I started it. I didn't have this structure in my mind about writing the four women and the four stories. It was just her story. And then while I was writing, I felt like she must have gave as an inheritance so much pain, but also life and joy to her own daughter, and her own daughter had experienced another tragedy, and so on and so forth. This is how the four women came to be. But then also the structure with the four queens wasn't in the beginning. Actually, the four names that start with Q were the result of when I had the idea of using the four queens of the cards as let's say a metaphor or a symbol of each one of these women. And the reason behind that was that I remembered one day while I was, in the process of writing, and maybe we can talk about that, because I don't write every day. When I'm writing a book, it's very intense, and then I stop for long periods of time. But when I'm writing a book, it's all I can think about. It's all I can do. I stop everything else. And it's a miracle how I can still be functioning as a human being when I'm in the writing period. So I remembered, because I was delving deep into my childhood, how during the war, when we used to run and sit in shelters, the civil war in Lebanon, many neighbors and families and my own parents used to play cards in order to pass time, you know, just talk about politics, play cards, stuff like that. And I used to watch that game. They used to play a game called Tarnib. Yeah. And it always, I remember how much I was frustrated and sometimes even furious that the king in the deck of cards would beat the queen. And I wouldn't understand. It was such a, even before, I was a kid, it wasn't just a post feminist realization of how patriarchy works and why does the king beat the queen and stuff like that. It was just, why is it so? They should be the same. And so when I was, when I remembered that story, I realized there are four queens beaten by the kings of this world. And not necessarily, when I say kings, it's not just I'm not talking about men. I'm talking about the whole patriarchal system, patriarchy, yeah, and whatever it represents and whatever damage it does to our lives. And this is how the idea of each one of them being one of these four queens. And then I made up a character for each queen of the deck of cards that was in tune with the character of one of the four heroines of the story.
Amazing. So thanks for the background. I wonder what the ace is in that case. Maybe the ace is the patriarchy.
I see them as one and not as stronger than the king. So it depends. Yeah. Sometimes they are, sometimes they're the strongest.
Yeah. Okay, I'm going to ask you an unanswerable question, but let's say you have a some teenager in your life that says, Joumana, you're writing a book about the Armenian genocide. What happened exactly? What happened in the Armenian genocide? And if you have to explain this as simply as possible to a teenager who knows Lebanon, knows Beirut, knows Syria, knows these places, has heard of Armenia, and is like, what happened?
Okay, so if this teenager, is familiar with the geographical and historical background, more or less, of the region that we live in, they would know that we had the Ottoman Empire rule this part of the world at one point, and many other parts as well. And there were, in what is known now as Turkey or Turkish cities like Aintab, like Mardin, like other cities, there were Armenian and other Christian minorities living there and thriving there. And at one point in 1915, the Ottomans decided to kick out the Armenians mainly, but also other Christian communities. And if you think about it, it's so absurd and maddening that more than 100 years later, 108 years later, the same is still happening in different parts of the world. Same kinds of wars motivated by whether religion or race or any other piece of identity or difference that we didn't even choose. I mean, I didn't choose to be born in Lebanon to a father from the south who has roots in Palestine and to a mother whose mother is from Aintab and whose grandfather is from Mardin and all this mixture that makes me who I am. I didn't choose it. And each one of us, none of us chose their name, their background, their nationality, their religion, etc., etc. But still, many times in many instances in our lives, in one form or another, we are punished because of that. We are punished because we're Muslim. We are punished because we're Christian. We are punished because we're women. We are punished because we're gay. We are punished for things that are just part of our nature and that we were born with, that we didn't choose, in order to at least say, okay, I'm punished, but I'm responsible for that. So I should accept the weight and the consequences of that choice I made, of that decision I made. We can't. So we're just completely unarmed and we pay the price of those of that inheritance that we have carried. And this is what happened to my grandmother and to my grandfather as well, who was Syriani, Assyriac, I guess you say in English. I'm not sure. I think it's Assyriac. Yeah. Who was born in Mardin. And this is how their whole life they had to pay the price of who they were without having decided to be who they were. And this is what happened in 1915. And more than a million people perished during that genocide. And hundreds of thousands of others got kicked out of their homeland, of their homes. Many went to Aleppo, but also from there to many other countries. There's a big Armenian diaspora everywhere in the world, whether in the United States or in different parts of the Arab world or in Europe. And it's a story of, their story. It's a story of such arbitrary violence and injustice. I mean, I know that violence and injustice is almost always arbitrary, but this is really, I mean, I'm seeing the photos that you're showing, and every time I see those photos, it still breaks my heart as if it was the first time. And it's the same reaction that I have whenever now I see, like, for example, photos or videos of Syrian refugees or of the atrocities that are still happening in Palestine or in many other or what's happening in Iran, for example, or many other parts of the world. It's the same reaction. It becomes, I mean, this kind of pain, once you've gone through it, becomes personal, even when it's someone else's pain that you're watching. It becomes, you become automatically, I mean, it becomes yours. You become empathetic and compassionate, and you feel it in your own flesh and blood, even if it's about someone else.
Yeah. Can you give us a scale? I don't want to put you on the spot, but I wonder if you still remember some of these numbers. Can you give us a scale of what, the size of the atrocities, just so that we can sort of get a sense of the number of people who had to move and lost lives and were placed in refugee camps? Do you remember these sort of details?
Well, not in a very scientific manner, but I do know that more than 1 million people were killed, were slaughtered. Oh, and obviously, I mean, some people say even 2 million, millions of others were, you know, just dispersed all over the world. So it was quite huge. I know that there are still a few very small Armenian community in Turkey, or what is known today as Turkey, but it's a very small group of Armenians.
Before you started writing this book, did you know this history inside and out? Because my sense is that most teenagers in Lebanon right now, for example, just because I'm only using Lebanon because both you and I are in Lebanon right now, I would imagine that most teenagers don't really know the history and know how their personal history is actually tied to this history. So before you started writing this book, were you intimately aware of the stories and of the sort of the nuances of what happened?
Definitely, yes, the story is, because I grew up in the Armenian ghetto in a place called Bourj Hammoud in Beirut. So I was surrounded with Armenians and I used to hear the stories and I used to see the tattoos. Many had tattoos and marks on their hands. And I used to ask questions to whoever was willing to answer me. Plus, when my grandmother committed suicide, I asked my mother to teach me Armenian. I wanted to speak the language, and she did. And I speak it fluently. So it also enabled me to discover and to hear things that wouldn't necessarily be available to maybe descendants of Armenians who are not who do not speak the language anymore. And there are many of those, unfortunately, today. So yes, I did, but not necessarily all the nuances. I mean, I knew the stories, but not the nuances. And it is only when obviously, in different parts of my life, I became more aware and more educated about it. But when I started to write the book, and because there were so many gaps that I had to fill, that's when I learned more, and I learned at a deeper level about the things that happened during that period.
Okay, I want to get into the book a little bit. You said you write these books in like spurts. Did you essentially write it chronologically?
I did write it chronologically as it is in the book, but not chronologically, because if you
yeah, no, I mean page by page, not chronologically, because you go back and forth.
I started with my grandmother, and then I decided, or with the let's say the generation of my grandmother, mm-hmm. and then I skipped a generation, and then I came back. So it was the same as it was in the book, but very very soon, I mean, when I started writing and I delved into the first chapter of the floor, I realized that, like I said at the beginning of our conversation, that there are more stories to tell about what this generation has given to the generation after it, and then to the generation after it. And then when I started writing, it was quite at the height of what was happening in Syria, and it was unbelievable that we were still caught in that vicious cycle of violence, of death, of hatred, of refusal of the other, of extremism, etc., etc. So I thought, this is I'm starting this, but it needs to end in our present time. So yeah, I did write it chronologically as it is in the book. But I didn't know how it was going to end. And the ending was a surprise even to me. I mean, I only came up with the ending a few days before I wrote the last pages of the book. And I like that, actually. I was always... Let's remember that this is my first novel. I mean, it's my 15th book, but it's my first novel. I've written lots of poetry, of nonfiction before. I've written plays. I've written children's books, but I hadn't written actually any novel. And this was my first novel. So I was like also discovering whether or not this is a genre that could work for me. I always had this idea that I was too impatient to write a novel. And maybe I am, but I had to push myself because I needed to get all those things out and be able to look at them and read them and not just think about them and deal with them from the inside perspective. So yeah, now I'm writing a new novel, and it's also a struggle because I want it to be done. I want it to be finished, and I have to force myself to respect the pace of the words, the pace of my own imagination, and just let go and not necessarily control every minute of the process.
Yeah, I want to talk about your new novel at the end of this conversation. But before we do, did you feel like you sort of exercised some of your demons by the end of it? Was there a sense of a relief or a sort of a sense of depression? Because it's such a heavy, it's such a heavy idea. Essentially, you're spanning, you know, a century almost, and it's, you know, it's a century of catastrophe after catastrophe after catastrophe after catastrophe after heartbreak after heartbreak. And you know, there's this quote in the book: memories are like morgues, endless rows of drawers that we continue, that we sometimes reopen to check up on our dead. Right?
Yeah.
An endless row of drawers. And it's almost like it's you are exploring the endlessness of the catastrophe and the heartbreak of life in this region. And so I wonder if at the end of it, you thought, okay, all right, okay, this is just going to be an endless row of drawers going forward. And if I wrote this book 100 years later, it would be a 200-year book.
Yeah.
Or was there a sense of relief, like, khalas, I exercised these demons and I can move on?
Honestly, no, there was no exorcism. The demons are still there. I don't believe necessarily in this idea that once we write, we liberate ourselves from whatever pain or tough memories or experiences that we hold inside. But on the other hand, there is some kind of relief that you find in the act of sharing that pain with others. I mean, the demons are still there, but the fact that you've opened your inside and showed other people those demons, pointed your finger at them, named your pain, gives you a certain sense of relief momentarily and not necessarily all the time. But the pain is still there. And I gotta tell you, I'm not someone who's necessarily optimistic. I'm a very joyful and cheerful and playful person, but I'm also quite a depressed person in by nature and also health-wise. And I do believe that, I mean, if it depends on how you look at it, but life is not... it's not that that happy experience after all. You have a few moments of good times every now and then, and you cherish them, of course. But there's a lot of pain and suffering. And I mean, maybe this is why, I mean, we have kids rather early in our lives. I did have both my kids very early in my life, because if I had to take that decision like at 40 years old or 38, maybe I would rethink it and not decide to impose this kind of suffering on another person. Because actually what we do when we take the decision of having kids is impose whatever life is going to be on someone who didn't decide to be born. So it's quite a big responsibility that we hold as parents. And I keep thinking about that. Yes, it is endless rows of drawers in a morgue, maybe not necessarily dead in the physical sense, but also loss and pain and lost. Not just people, but also or loved ones, lost opportunities, lost experiences. So it's living is heavy. Living is heavy in itself, and having to write about it is obviously heavy. And this is why maybe I write in spurs, because I'm not always well equipped and in order to do that kind of confrontation. It always needs for me to reassemble my courage and my guts and my insolence and my thinking, I don't care, I'm gonna do that, in order to be able to sit down and do it. And I keep postponing and postponing and postponing until the moment of actually doing it becomes inescapable. And this is what happened with this book, but it also happens with all my books. I just keep running away from this because it's hard and because I never write if not from a very individual experience or spot. It's always very personal. Everything I write is very personal. So it's not like I'm writing, I'm inventing something that I have a sense of detachment from. Even when I'm inventing, it's very personal.
One of the... thanks for sharing that. I mean, I can't imagine it's very, you know, it's so tied to the stuff that we talked about with the experience of, you know, at the age of 7, seeing somebody you love in your family do something so tragic to themselves. I can't imagine that that's a shadow that that ever really goes away. So I imagine that that's super, super heavy. I want to ask you a question. In Afikra, in our world here, every now and then we get people who have the sense of Arab exceptionalism, right? And they're so excited that we are, that as Afikra, we're celebrating amazing, quote unquote, Arab stories and how amazing Arabs are. And everything is how amazing that this group of people is. And that's not what we're doing. Afikra is not about any specific group of people. It's about this region that some people call the Arab world, which includes so many different types of people and so many different types of cultures. And this book is one of the first, is the first book that we've had on book club that is about Armenians, which at least in the Levant play a huge part of shaping the histories and the cultures of the last, you know, few centuries, if not more. And so I'm curious, let me ask you the question as straightforward as I can. Why aren't there more books about Armenian stories from this part of the world?
I'm sorry, it's skipped a word or two. Can you repeat the question, please?
Yeah, of course. Why aren't there more stories about Armenians from this part of the world?
Okay. Yeah, you're right. I mean, I always wonder about that as well. But it's really, I mean, when you were talking about Arab exceptionalism, I felt provoked, honestly, because I don't believe in that. I don't believe in exceptionalism of any kind of people, honestly. I believe in the exceptional nature of each and every human being. We're all unique and exceptional, but there isn't something called Arab exceptionalism. And and I don't know if it's the problem of the language regarding Armenians, because it's a small community after all. And I know there are amazing books by Armenian Americans who have written about this. There are even also amazing movies about this. But it's true that in Lebanon, there aren't, or in the Arab world, there aren't, to my knowledge, many books that have been written about this. Maybe it was because whether the Armenians or the Arabs, each in their own way, wanted to be absorbed or accepted, or wanted to absorb and accept this what is considered different element in the community. I know that it's in the case of Lebanon, until now, I know many Armenians who say, for example, about Lebanese, bint Arab, which means that they don't consider themselves 100% Lebanese. There's a different, you know, there's a nuance there. And vice versa, also the Arabs or the Lebanese say he's Armenian, as in to pinpoint that they're not 100% Lebanese. To me, I think that we are 100% Lebanese, because I mean, we're all a mixture, we're all hybrids, each and every one of us. But I do understand something that the Armenians are blamed for usually, for example, in Lebanon, and it's that they are they stick together and they form a more or less protected community. I mean, it's because they need to uphold their language, their culture, their own story, their own experiences. And I understand that, and we should all accept it. I mean, we should celebrate these different elements in each and every communities, instead of wanting to turn everything into a homogeneous shade. Obviously, also, on the other hand, we have a problem with that in Lebanon, in that we are not Lebanese. Not even those who are 100%, if that exists, Lebanese aren't Lebanese, because before being Lebanese, they are Christians, Catholics, Shias, Sunnis, Druze. And this is our tragedy in Lebanon, in that we do not have this sense of belonging to one culture. It could be a source of richness and variety, but unfortunately, it's first and foremost, in our case, a cause of division and hatred and inability to be united as a people. And it's sad. It's sad. Yeah. I mean, when I think about Lebanon, it's just it's a mess. What can I say?
Yeah. How was this book received? You know, it deals with a subject that we don't typically hear about. What has the reception been so far from the sort of the broader public?
Actually, it's been amazing. I mean, lots of people, lots of readers have told me that they loved it, but they told me that it was a tough read. And I understand that. when a reader tells me that she or he had to put down the book and try to breathe for a few days before reading more, I understand that because I had to deal with it myself. And I actually didn't know how it would be received while I was writing it, because it was, like you said a bit earlier, there's no break. It's just loss after loss after loss, suffering after suffering. But this is how it is. And at one point in the book, I wonder if it's possible for one person to experience all that pain. But the answer is yes, it's possible, and even more, unfortunately. So it was very well received, and it's one of the reasons that have empowered and encouraged me to write more fiction, because like I said, I wasn't necessarily conceiving myself as someone who can, as a writer who can write fiction or novels, but it turns out I can. So I really found in the reactions and the positive reactions to it, the strength to and the inspiration to keep on trying to do that. Not because nonfiction is not important. Now, for example, I'm writing two separate books. One is fiction in English and one is nonfiction in Arabic. But because I enjoyed while writing it, I enjoyed the discovery of my ability to invent things while also discovering things in myself and in my own family and in my own story. But you have to invent. And I didn't think I was able of doing that. And it turns out it's enthralling, because sometimes we say or think or write things and we think, who's going to believe that? But then people believe it. And it's the same whenever I'm reading a book of fiction. I always receive that book of fiction as absolute truth, as if it's something that has actually happened. I'm never reminded or remind myself while I'm reading that this is fiction. And this is how literature should be received, because like many writers have said and many readers have said, it surpasses fiction many times. It surpasses invention. Our own inventions in literature surpass life. I mean, this is what I wanted to say.
Yeah, for sure. I mean, but the ability for it to be believable speaks to your work and your challenge as an author, which is to make it internally consistent and to make the characters emotionally believable and have the depth to actually think that this is a believable story. This is actually integrates with the truth, you know? Did you like specific characters more than others? Did you like spending time with specific characters more than others?
No. I had reasons to like and dislike all four of them, actually. I'm talking about the four women.
Yeah.
Maybe dislike is not the word, but distance myself from them. I had reasons to be crazy about them, but also to sometimes to judge them admonish them equally while I was creating them. So no, but the least favorite is the character that represents my own generation, maybe because we're always more tougher towards ourselves than we are with other people. So she was my least favorite.
Did people in your family come and interrogate you saying, I didn't do that, why did you
No, because I mean, they are used to who I am, and they're always worried. Like, for example, even in my nonfiction books, it's more more testimonies than nonfiction. Even my essays, they're always testimonies. I always draw the inspiration from my own life, from my own experiences. And the funny thing is, after this book came out, my brother, I have just one brother, and he told me, if the next book is about me, I'm going to kill you, because this is this is what's left. So please don't come anywhere near me, because I don't want to find myself in one of your books. So they're used to me, and they know that one of my most favorite challenges when I'm writing is how transparent and genuine I can be. This is what I enjoy the most about this confrontation. And this is why also I keep running away from it, because it's so hard to just get naked down to your core and write. But this is what writing is to me. If I'm not like that, I don't want to write. I'm not interested in it.
Yeah. Do you choose the language that a book is written in? You just mentioned that you're writing one book in Arabic and one writing in English. Do you choose the language based off the audience you want to read it? Or do you choose it based off the emotion you use to express it?
Neither the first nor the second. I don't choose. It's very weird, my experience with languages. I've written books in 5 different languages. I speak 7, but I cannot write in 2 of them. And in it, it's always been a matter of the idea of the book comes in a particular language, and I just abandoned myself to it, and I started doing it in that language. Like after the Book of Queens, I've written a novel in Arabic called Victim Number 232 about the port explosion in Beirut. Now I'm writing a novel in English, and I'm writing a nonfiction book, essays about feminism in Arabic. So it's I've written a children's book in Italian, a poetry book in Spanish, an erotic book in French. So it's just a matter of, I think that it's clear now from what I've said so far how much writing to me is a group of challenges that I have to face. And one of these challenges is the language that I'm expressing myself with. It's another challenge to be able to explore yourself in a language that is not necessarily your own, that you didn't grow up with, but I make it my own. And it also brings out words and ideas and images that are not necessarily available in another language. So it brings out a side of me as a writer that is not expressible or expressed in another language. So it's, I just let go. It comes in English, I write it in English. It comes in French, I write it in French. And regarding the audience, I never think about that, because whatever the language I choose, my main audience is the Arab world and Arabic. So whenever I write a book in English, for example, I make sure that it's published in Arabic the same time it's published in English. It's not because, you know why I say that? Because many times, especially in the beginning, people think that a writer is running away from his own native language in order not to say things that might feel difficult to say in his or her own language and easier to express in a language with which you have a certain distance. And it's not the case with me. It's always, it's very arbitrary, the choice of the language, and it's always published in Arabic as well as in other languages.
So for those listening to the podcast who can't see the screen, I have a screenshot of one of the, an excerpt, and it says, Beirut, Tuesday, November 10th, 1970, poverty is a soul breaker, poverty is a soul breaker, and then in all caps, poverty is a soul breaker. And it reminds me to something that you said earlier on. You were alluding to the neighborhood you grew up, Bourj Hammoud, and you described it as a ghetto. I've never heard anyone describe Bourj Hammoud as a ghetto.
Really?
Yeah, and I'm curious, what are your memories of that neighborhood in the early 70s and going into the war? I'd love to hear what that neighborhood felt like at that time in your childhood.
A lot of poverty. I am from a very modest, even poor family. I grew up in these circumstances, but fortunately, what made a difference in my life is that my parents gave our education, mine and my brother's, a huge importance and did everything in order for us to realize how important it was to be educated in order to emancipate ourselves, at least to the minimum, from such conditions that can be tough and can break your soul. But I was surrounded with people who were like us, and it's obviously to various degrees, because there's always worse and there's always better. And I know how, especially from my mom's ordeals, in order to provide us with everything we needed, and everything we had to have, I know how difficult it is sometimes to have to break your challenge your self-esteem. I remember one thing in particular, which I'm gonna tell. I remember that, for example, I was in a school run by nuns, and I remember that they made me, I was like maybe 5 or 6 years old, because my parents didn't pay the tuition on time. They singled me out and made me leave the class and sit on the stairs because my parents hadn't paid the tuition. This is something that you have to, I cannot forget something like that, even if it was, I mean, a very early memory. I cannot forget that my mom wanted, and I've written about this. I think I tell that story in the book as well, how she badly desired a dress in a shop window. And I could see in her eyes how much she wanted it, but she wouldn't buy it because she had to buy more necessary stuff for us, her kids. I remember how one day I saw her kneeling in front of my brother's school director in order for him to give her a discount on the tuition, because she wanted to keep my brother in that excellent school, and she didn't want, you know. So these are things that form you as a human being, even when you reach a point where you're living a comfortable life. You cannot forget these things, and they form you, and they shape you, and they shape the way you look at others, and they shape the way you look at things. And I'm grateful. I know it's a cliche to say that, but I'm grateful for those experiences. Since I'm grateful I went through them. And sometimes I worry because I went through that, I insisted so much on not allowing my two sons, I have a 30-year-old son and a 23-year-old son, on not having my two sons be exposed to any form of worry on that front when they were kids and even now. And I worry because they didn't worry. Because the fact that I worried when I was young has given me a form of immunity, but also a certain kind of strength to face life and its adversities in a way that maybe they're not equipped for. And I worry about that, you know?
Yeah. Yeah. Yeah, I get it. But yeah. Thanks for sharing. It's really, really tough to imagine what that's like, but I really appreciate the clarity. I want to ask, before we wrap up, we only have a few more minutes, to talk a little bit about victim number 232, which is, I believe, coming out in July, or just came out, or it's coming out soon.
Came out in July in Arabic, July. And now it's being translated to English.
Yeah, so tell us a little bit about that book.
So this is also a beautiful writing story. Not the story of the book, but the story of the writing itself. Because during the when before right before the revolution, the October 17th revolution started in Lebanon, and on October 17, 2019, I had started writing a book about a main character who's a trans woman. Called Hinnid, who was born Abbas, and she's from a southern family. I had been writing the book for, thinking about the main character for quite some time, and I started writing the parts of the book, and then the explosion on 4 August 2020 happened. Obviously, like each and every other person in Beirut, I had to stop everything. Our lives were paused, and we barely made it. I live like 200 meters away from the port. Fortunately, I didn't personally get physically hurt or lose a loved one. And this is to say how trying it has been, and it still is, for those who did lose loved ones in that tragedy, in that crime. But I had to help others. You know, we all went to the streets, helping each other, cleaning the houses, cleaning the streets, et cetera, et cetera. And then 6 months later, when the dust, more or less, whether the literal dust or the, the moral and psychological dust started to settle down, I decided to get back to writing the book. And I couldn't. I did everything I could. I couldn't get back to writing the book. And then I took a two-month residency in France, writing residency, in order to finish it. And I couldn't. And while in France, I realized that the main character was another victim of the port explosion, because she died. She died on me. My main character, the main character of the book, died on me. And it was quite a coincidence, because she lived in Karantina. And Karantina was actually, in truth, one of the places that were most affected by the explosion, because it faces the Beirut port. So I decided to just let go of Hinnid. I wrote just a conclusion for the book, a final chapter, where I tell the story of the writing and how I, as well, have lost someone in that explosion. It wasn't a real person. It was a fictional character, but I still felt the loss. And I named it victim number 232, because by that time, we had 231 victims of the explosion. And then I was telling my publisher was asking me what I was working on. And I told him that I was about to start a new book, because that one is, I didn't think I would publish it, but I wanted to get my closure with it. And this is why I wrote the conclusion. And he told me, let's publish it as it is, as an incomplete book, as a novel interrupted by the explosion. And this is what we did. And it tells the story of the explosion in an indirect way, because it was never written to be about the explosion, but the explosion interfered with it. This is the story of the book.
How powerful. It's almost, I almost wish the name of the book wasn't Victim 232. Just because it sort of spoils the narrative that you just explained to me, which is like, you're reading this story of, you know, of aspirations and hopes and dreams and unresolved questions, and then at 6:37, everything changes. Joumana, we are out of time. I could talk to you for a really long time, and I hope we have
another
follow-up to this conversation. For all of you listening, it's easy to find Joumana online, J Haddad Official on Instagram, and you can look up the JH Freedom Center as well. Joumana, thanks so much for joining us. It was a real privilege to be able to speak to you.
Thank you so much. Thank you. It's been wonderful.